Good evening, you're watching NewsX with me, Devika Chopra. Now, the past 1 month has been very exciting with new findings and discoveries coming to light almost every week. Kizari, which has been the source of all of this excitement, was in the fifth phase of excavations. In this phase, over 900 artifacts have now been unearthed over the course of 4 months. Archaeologists dug up 51 trenches during their explorations of Kizari. The more we've looked, the more we've found, and that's what's truly fascinating. So just yesterday, a report was released on an orange carnelian stone that was found at this site engraved with the image of a wild boar. Now this stone, which could be possibly about 2,000 years old, isn't even found in Tamil Nadu, but in northwestern India. So this one tiny bead has provided the link between what could be an ancient north and south trade link. Then another report showed possible links between the script that was used in the Indus Valley civilization and the Tamzihi script, which is the father of modern-day Tamil. The graffiti, which has been found in earthen pots, has remarkable similarities to symbols found in artifacts from the Indus Valley sites. And the fact that they were found on earthen pots actually indicates at a highly literate community. Another landmark discovery that was reported recently from Kizari was the existence of an urban civilization on the riverbed of Vaigai that was contemporary to the Gangetic Plain civilization. So all of these discoveries from Kizari have shown what could be possible links between Indus and southern culture. Everything changed in 2015 when ASI began excavations at the Kizari site on the banks of the Vaigai River. This site, just 12 kilometers from Madurai, has revolutionized the understanding of not just ancient Tamil region, but in also providing concrete evidence of an ancient urban settlement in Tamil Nadu, similar to the Indus Valley civilization. The Kizari site has provided overwhelming evidence of an urban settlement as complex as those found at the Indus Valley and Gangetic sites, with artifacts carbon dated to 200 BCE, all linked to the Sangam era, which is considered the golden age of Tamil culture between 4th century BCE to 2nd century CE, when many of its epics were composed. But unfortunately, the excavations have also faced many political hurdles. As this phase, now the fifth phase, comes to an end, we need to unite in this cause of finding more about our past and perhaps rewriting history that can provide a link that unites Indians like never before. And to take this conversation forward, I'm being joined on the broadcast by Mr. Narayan Tirupati of the BJP. Rahul Ishwar will be joining me shortly as well. Abhijit Chawla, a history researcher, will also be joining us. And I have with me Ms. Uma Anandan as well. So let me begin this conversation with Ms. Uma Anandan. You know, Ms. Anandan, I must begin by asking, considering that the fifth phase of explorations has now come to an end, the findings that we've seen in the past month and the links that they've provided between the north and the south, what does this mean for contemporary India?
See, first of all, we're all happy because it breaks the propaganda of the Dravidian parties in Tamil Nadu, which said that the Dravidians were chased away from the Indus Valley. They spoke about the Aryan supremacy and always say people on the other side of the Vindhyas are all Aryans, and even the Brahmins in Tamil Nadu are Aryans, and they always find a sore spot on this, and their entire propaganda is on this. So this particular thing which states that there is no Dravidian Aryan myth, there is no Dravidian this thing at all. The same Indus Valley people have lived in South India also. Mm-hmm. And another thing is, it is just not mere 3,000 years. I think the Tamil history goes beyond that. Because in Mahabharata, we speak about Arjuna marrying a Pandyan prince. So if Arjuna has married a Pandyan prince, the Tamil civilization is much, much, much ancient. More than, and we always take pride on the literacy level of the Tamils. The Tamil language, the Brahmi script now opens on that. So we Tamils have every right to be proud about it. But the link to the Dravidian parties here to say that the Aryan and the Dravidian invasion, the Dravidians being thrown away, that's a big myth, and we are happy that it is being taken forward. And my this thing is, this Tamil civilization is much more ancient than this 3000 years that you're talking about.
Right, all right, okay, so fair enough, the Tamil civilization is perhaps more ancient, but then my question to you, ma'am, is that considering that this could possibly be, a link which shows that we were perhaps one large Indic civilization, one large Indic race, considering that, the site Rakhigiri, yes, where they found the DNA, where they found that one DNA sample of a woman that once again shows, it's completely devoid of any DNA of Iranian farmers or the steppe pastoralists, which is what has been the dominant DNA found in that particular area. So, all of these findings have pointed towards what could be possibly a time where we need to start relooking at our history. So that's the question that I want to ask to you, and that's the question that I pose, that what does this then mean in bringing contemporary India together? Because we have for far too long been fed, all of these theories about the North and the South having absolutely no link, no cultural links and no historical links.
That's what I told you, it is very obvious that the Indus Valley civilization has spread all over. It was not confined to Sindh alone or part of Afghanistan or Pakistan now or the Indus Valley alone. Even the South India has been part of the Indus Valley civilization. That is why I said these Dravidian parties throwing off the Dravidian myth, that's the biggest plus point of this discoveries. So as of this thing, it takes about India, the extended India, not just India of geographical area of today alone. It goes beyond that, the Agand Bharat. There is no connection between Russia, the steppes they used to say, but that has been ruled out now. So the Indian pastoral, this thing is as ancient, and it takes the India as a whole itself, with even part of Afghanistan, everywhere. So the myth of India, the North-South divide, that is all thrown down now. It is nothing but simply a myth.
All right,
the truth is India as one, and as ancient, the Indus Valley civilization together. We are part, the Vindhyas, this side of the Vindhyas, we are part of the Indus Valley civilization. That is what this speaks about.
Right, absolutely.
And let's take pride in that.
All right, so let me bring in Mr. Narayan Tirupathi into the conversation as well. Mr. Tirupathi, then, so we've seen that even excavations at this particular site have hit several political hurdles. One in 2017, when the ASI was taken away from the site and the Tamil Nadu government then had to intervene and put its own archaeology department, up to the task. Why are we so hell-bent on politicizing something that could truly unite India?
No, what has happened is, see, this Kirindi site was, found only from a temple, carved on a stone in a temple. So that is what I have been hearing. And leftist-centered people, particularly left-oriented people, they wanted to showcase that the Kirindi civilization is something different from Indus Valley civilization. And they in fact try to say that it is a religious-less civilization what they had, and they wanted to prove that Tamil civilization is something very different from other civilization what we have. But the recent revelations, the recent excavations have proved that we are one, as you rightly said, the Indic Valley and the Indic civilization, and it is proved that, and more things, see, even only 10% of the excavations are over. More than 150 kilometers or 200 kilometers from Madurai, the Vaigai river bed, we goes up to, up to Ramanathapuram, Mandapam, we've got Sakudi, we've got Maranade, we've got so many Pambavardhan, so many places, all these excavations have to be done. Even in Kirindi, you've got another 90% to be done. But sensing this, some leftist movement and some organizations with the vested interest trying to prove that the Arya Dravida myth will be out. And so far for the past 50-60 years, they have been ruling this state, and they never wanted the power to go, and they created all kinds of problems here with having some officials, archaeological department people also in their hands, and they were trying to prove that this is a different civilization. But now that media, thanks to NewsX particularly, going there, and every day we are showing what all we are getting it. And they were irritating the archaeology people also who were, went there. They were disturbing them. Lot of problems had happened. But now we have spoken to the concerned ministry in Tamil Nadu, and they are definitely cooperating. Very soon this Kedadi museum will be showcased, and we will come to know what was the civilization and what all we have
right, absolutely.
And what is
hopefully.
The link we have with Mohenjo-Daro,
hopefully
Harappa.
It will hopefully
all
things
the, yes,
will
all
become
things will be done within a short while. The
absolutely, and I'll come back to you,
yes.
Sir, I'll give you an
but,
opportunity
the
to
problem is that these people will start crying.
Truly, and that's what, and I'll come back to that aspect as well, of how to depoliticize the entire issue, because since the time media has been giving some attention, and it would be amazing to see more perhaps mainstream channels picking up topics like these, putting it out there, for the public to really consume and know what all discoveries are being made in India, because this is something that we should truly be talking about in today's day and age, considering the sort of divisive politics that there is. But at the same time, like I said, I will come back to the depoliticization of this issue as well. But joining me on the broadcast is Abhijit Chawla, who's a history researcher. Abhijit, the fifth phase is now over. So, just for the benefit of our viewers, if you could tell us what, as per you, have been the big takeaways in these, in the past 4 months, or what's been found?
Yes, so the fifth phase is over now, and they have found many, I'm hearing an echo. So they have been able to find many more artifacts. They have found evidence of, sorry, I'm getting a sound problem.
All right, okay, we'll try to fix your audio line, but let me then come back to my guests. Mr. Tirupati, then back to you, sir. My question then is, how do we then, moving forward, depoliticize this entire matter? And is there a plan in place now by the central government to provide
that
assistance?
That has been clear, that's what I said. Yes. See, actually speaking, is that now there was a communication gap between the National Archaeology Department and also the State Archaeology Department. Now that the central and state governments have come together, we have understood, we have elaborated the problem to the state government, and the concerned minister, Mr. Pandeyrajan, he has visited the site, and our Nirmala Sitharaman, Magesh Sharma, everybody visited the site, and now. See, these people want to, fortify that, portray that it is a different culture. Race was living in this area. It is not so. And that we have definitely blocked it. We have definitely blocked it. And our state government has requested for so many help from the central government. Most importantly, the funding part. And the government has promised that from some departments they will do it. And also we have said, particularly in South India, we've got only in Bangalore, you have a research institute and all those things. Whereas in South India, you don't have anything. So these people tried to create a very big problem, from Bangalore also. And in Dehradun, we have one unit. So they went to the court. Lot of legal problems were there. All these things were, sorted out by the central government and also the state government. So soon we will be clearing everything.
Absolutely, hopefully everything will work out, at least sixth phase almost. Uma Nandan wanted to come in there, and then I'll come back to Abhijit.
See, this particular thing, the communist MP from that place tried to hijack this and want, see, they've always, their politics has been as if Tamils are separate from the entire part of India. They wanted to hijack this issue, and they were not being transparent about the entire findings there. We are happy that right now this particular, as Mr. Tripathi correctly said, this sort of onslaught has been stopped. The wrong interpretation of our history, again the same thing that continued, you know, that has been put to an end. And definitely this part of civilization, it is just not mere 3,000 years old. It is beyond that. So it will more or less see the Tamils have had a same urban setting more just as Indus Valley as this site shows. The urban city development, the artifacts that have been found, they are very much similar to Indus Valley. Hmm. So I don't think any more of these Dravidian Aryan myth will buy votes for them anymore. I think once and for all, this argument by the Dravidian and the Communist Party should be put an end to by the Ministry of Culture.
Yeah, absolutely. Hopefully that will happen. Let me come back to Abhijit then. Abhijit, if you can hear us now, you know, just for the sake of the benefit of our viewers watching this, if you could, as a history researcher, just probably elaborate on what have been the most major takeaways of this phase.
Every year there have been further excavations, and so far what we have found is that they have gone down to a depth of about 300 or 400 centimeters, and which goes back to around 500 or 600 BCE, and they have found evidence of buildings, evidence of canals and sewage systems. They have found ring wells, brick walls. They have found pottery with some Brahmi words and names. They have found ornaments, beads, etc. And so far, even after all these phases, less than 10% of the site has been excavated. So there is a lot more to be done. But what we have found so far is that there is evidence that there were considerable linkages between this particular site in Kiledi and other sites in Tamil Nadu, and also with other places in the north of India. For example, the Tamil Brahmi script itself shows a clear linkage between North India and South India. And like the lady said, the urban development of the site is very similar to what we used to see in the Indus Valley civilization. So there are very clear linkages between this site and the rest of India. So the entire thesis or the hypothesis that the Kiledi represents a South Indian or Tamil civilization, it is entirely incorrect, because as we can see, there are so many linkages.
Okay, so Abhijit, then truly, what do these findings then really mean for us today?
So what these findings tell us is that we need to have an integrated plan to eliminate the significant gaps that we have in Indian history. It's not about rewriting our history, it's about filling up the major gaps that we have in Indian history. For example, what happens is that we are teaching 19th century colonial history right now in schools, in colleges, and universities. We have absolutely no idea about India's history before 2500 BCE, before the Mauryan era and the Buddhist times. So we need to find out what our history was like in those times. And the key to the enterprise is science. It's hard science. So I am a scientist. I firmly believe that it's time to rid ourselves of the mumbo-jumbo of the humanities. We need to bring hard science into the study of history. Basically, archaeology and the study of ancient history must become a multidisciplinary scientific enterprise. For example, we can use artificial intelligence and machine learning to try and decipher the Harappan script and identify the language and correlate it with Brahmi and other scripts. We can use forensic archaeology. We can use radiocarbon dating, accelerator mass spectrometer dating. We can use radioisotope analysis. We can use optically stimulated luminescence dating. We can do hydrological analysis of the Kiledi region and the Vaigai River Valley. We can understand the fluvial morphodynamics of the river system. We can do sediment analysis. And also, we need to bring in ancient DNA, the study of archaeological ancient DNA,
right,
to ascertain the Y DNA and mitochondrial DNA haplogroups. Because these things, they all show us that Indian civilization was a composite civilization. It was very vast, and the people of India are the same, whether it goes to North India or South India. So this is what needs to happen going forward.
Okay, all right. Uma Anandan wants to come in there.
See, this another interesting factor in this is the flow of Vaigai River. See, we normally think the Vaigai River is confined only to Madurai, but now it looks as if the Vaigai River has been flowing even beyond the Ramanathapuram and all that. It is beyond that. The flow of Vaigai itself is wrong as of now when we look about it. Because right now we think of Vaigai River confined only to Madurai region. But from the excavations of this, it looks as if Vaigai has been going beyond Madurai, it has been going up to Ramanathapuram and all that. That itself is another big discovery, I would call. The river, how did the flow change? How did the flow of River Vaigai change to the present thing? Why has it changed its direction? What are the factors that have made that?
Right, absolutely.
See, these are all another interesting factor that opens about it.
Right, so Ms. Anandan, my question to you then, ma'am, is are we somewhere failing to gauge the importance and the significance of the discoveries that are being made? Ms. Uma Anandan.
Yeah, what are you asking?
Yeah, my question, ma'am, is that are we somewhere failing to gauge the importance and significance of all of these discoveries that are being made?
Definitely, yes. See, we never knew to respect our heritage. We never knew how to protect our this thing. But now we take a lot of pride in this. We want the Ministry of Culture, we just like Egypt and Rome. We also are very rich, one of the ancient civilizations. We never knew how to protect them or how to project them to the world. But right now, we have a living civilization of ours. So right now, let's take pride in that. Let's showcase it to the world in a proper manner.
All right, Abhijit, I have the same question to you, sir. Then, you know, do you also believe somewhere that we have really miserably failed to understand what is going on, what is happening, what do these discoveries mean for us, and why do you think that's happening?
Yes, I completely agree, because we are the world's oldest continuously existing civilization. Our history goes back, from the archaeological record, our history goes back at least 10,000 years. And we have no idea of about 7,000 to 8,000 years of this history. I mean, we have done no research about this. So it is really embarrassing. If you look at other countries, like Madam said, if you look at Egypt, for example, if you look at this small place called Israel, where they have this so-called holy land, if you see the amount of archaeological research they are doing, multidisciplinary research they are doing, if you look at China, the industrial scale on which they are doing research into their past, into their history, we can learn from that. We need to have a proper integrated program to do all this. Because if you do not know your past, you're going to have no future. It's very important that we learn about our past so that we don't repeat the mistakes of the past, and we also build upon whatever our heritage is. So it is very important that we do this, and it is vital for our political leadership to understand this, mm-hmm. and it is vital for them to invest in this so that we can start making progress on this front.
Right, absolutely. Mr. Tirupati wanted to come in there.
No, see, I don't think we have failed or something, you know, but you know, this archaeology department, it takes its own time. You know, the Saraswati River, we have been, you know, for many thousands of years. Now we find a lot of facts about Saraswati River. So archaeology doesn't come like that. Overnight we cannot do anything. And as far as Kiridi is concerned, there are some vested interests. There are some people who wants to damage the fabric of the country. They have, as told by Uma Anandan, the Marxist Communist MP, he wrote a lot of stories on this. But he has hidden a lot of facts. With the colluding with some people, he tried to, you know, bury a lot of history. But we are very clear. Archaeology department takes its own time. It may even take another 7 or 10 years. But we have to wait, because we have to give time to examine, to research, to authenticate, to justify. And you need to compare. See, in single day, we cannot do anything. This has to be done very slowly, steadily, and a realistic approach, practical approach will take its own time, even many years, we don't know. So, because we are not experts in archaeology. So, definitely,
okay.
The government, whoever is doing, whether it is state government or central government, we cannot hide facts. So, we have not failed. In fact, we are slowly, we are improving, and definitely, we will know who we were and what the Kiridi means. And you know, this Vaigai belt, it covers, as I
rightly
said, Uma Anandan also said, up to Ramanathapuram, up to We have got a lot of places.
No, but I have a counter question.
I
have a counter question for you, sir, then, on the politics. I have a counter question and I'll ask that because but Abhijit and both Ms. Anandan want to come in there. Abhijit, first you.
Yes, so there is no doubt that archaeology takes time. But I would say that the Archaeological Survey of India is a highly bureaucratic organization, and it is an organization that belongs to the colonial past. Because, I mean, if you look at the track record of preserving our monuments, it is abysmal. It is time to close the Archaeological Survey of India and start a new organization, a professional scientific organization, which can do things in a proper time frame, and they can do it properly in a professional manner. And secondly,
right.
I know that it takes time. It takes time, I agree. So we need to have a proper program, let's say a 20-year program, in which we have milestones, and then we need to follow those milestones, and we need to do things on time. So I don't disagree that it takes time, but let's have a proper time frame, and let's follow the schedule, right? That's what we can do.
Right, absolutely. And because, you know, the fact of the matter is, and I didn't want to focus on the politics of it too much today, because our focus should be entirely different. And that's why we need to continue having this conversation. And that's why I didn't bring up these matters. But like I said in the beginning as well, that this particular site has also faced many political hurdles. In 2016, there were issues about fund allocation. Then in 2017, the ASI archaeologist who was leading the excavations was transferred to Assam. That had raked up a storm, which is when the Tamil Nadu Archaeological Department, the State Department, took over the excavations. So all of these political hurdles have been there, and it's time now to put politics completely aside, because what could be unearthed here is far greater than any politics that has ever mattered. Uma Anandan, last word to you, ma'am.
See, I would like to say once again, as the professor said, the ASI needs to be revamped. They are totally short of staff. Mm. As you said, this is such a huge pride for us as Indians. One of the ancient civilizations we have founded. I bet there are a lot of Kiradi sites all over India. It to be waiting for archaeologists and our experts to open up. So, but we do not know how to protect them, how to showcase them. We are definitely, the ASI has failed miserably in that. And also the political interference. That is why we are telling that we need to protect and showcase our pride as the most ancient civilization and the living civilization in the world today.
Right, absolutely, ma'am. Thank you so much for wrapping that up for us. Mr. Tirupati was there with us on the broadcast, so hopefully some cues have been picked up from what it is, the suggestions that have been made for the government now moving forward for both the central as well as the state government, considering how to really preserve and conserve what is India's pride. Thank you so much for watching.
For more such videos, subscribe to the NewsX YouTube channel, hit the bell icon.